Ahmedabad, this is an initiative by the Talk. The theme of today's session is Rising to the Challenge with Tech Advantage. My name is Muthu and I'm the founder and owner of the brand named Crumbles. It's an organic cookies brand. CEO Talk is a platform to share ideas, insights to transform organizations, to create a better and transparent forum for meaningful business relationships and partnerships. This event is brought to you by Tata Telebusiness Services. It is the country's leading enabler of connectivity and communication solutions for businesses. They offer services ranging from connectivity, collaboration, cloud IoT security, and marketing solutions. Tata Telebusiness Services offers the largest portfolio of ICT services for business in India. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to start this panel discussion by introducing the eminent speakers who have joined us today. Now, I know this is a virtual session, but please give a good round of applause as I introduce the panelists so that we have a good energy flowing inside the room. I'd like to start by introducing Mr. Vikas Punjabi, founder of the Chocolate Room India. Welcome, sir. Followed by Mr. Chandra Singh Purohit, Group CFO, Clarins Group of Companies. Welcome, sir. Mr. Chinmay Shah, Director, Crescent Electronics Private Limited. Welcome, sir. Mr. Nilam Patel, Managing Director, India Operations, S&P Global. Welcome, sir. Chartered Accountant Pooja Khemka, CEO and Co-Founder, TrackNow Private Limited. Welcome, ma'am. I'm also honored and pleased to recognize the presence of Mr. Manu Singh, Vice President Operations, West Region, Tata Telebusiness Services. Welcome, sir. Sir, I'd like to request you to give a short opening remarks for today's session. Over to you, sir.
Yeah. Thanks, Muthu. Can I request everyone please put your phone on mute? Yeah. Muthu, can you just, yeah, no, it's fine. Good afternoon, everyone. And, while the topic is the rising for the challenge, and we know the concept of earlier from the office, and now it is work from home and then work from everywhere. And we know as the world grapples with ongoing pandemic and organizations are forced to offer digital transformation at the workplace, transforming the workplace experience requires holistic strategy that combines technology, operation, culture, and employee experience. Hence, agility, flexibility take the center stage of process of transformation. However, one of the key challenges still remain around us, where to begin, how to unlock the value inside the workplace. Technological disruption in the area of artificial intelligence, machine learning, IoT, CRM, cloud adaptations, etc., can enable organizations implement this digital transformation seamlessly. I welcome you all to the Do Big Digital CEO Series 2021, a CEO's networking session with theme Rising to the Challenge. I'm looking forward for having your diverse thought and making this event an enriching and engaging session. Thank you very much. Over to you, Muthu.
Thank you, Manu, sir, for setting the tone of today's session on track, and also for that wonderful opening remark. Yes, let's quickly jump on to today's panel discussion. Looking back at the last year, I think it has been a roller coaster for each and every one of us, both on terms of professional and personal aspects as well. Some businesses boomed during the pandemic, some had a huge pitfall and all that. But we cannot deny the fact that it was during this pandemic that the adoption of technology grew exponentially like never before, right? So there was a lot of adoption towards technology during this pandemic. Speaking about which, I'd like to start today's panel discussion with a very generic question. What are some of the biggest challenges faced by the business in the current situation with respect to enabling remote working? So I'd like to start with Mr. Vikas.
It's a really nice question. With pandemic, actually, before pandemic, we had an office full of staff working all around us. And we being into franchise industry, we keep on franchising and getting up new stores, tying up to people, having one-to-one sessions with them, approving with them. So working on remote thing, it gets a bit harder in our business, because what happens is when someone is interested in taking a franchise of our brand, through a phone call conversation or through visiting any of our franchises cafe, there all questions are not answered. So before investing a 40 to 50 lakhs on a store, which is a standard investment, what they want to do to set up our store, they don't feel comfortable. They want to come to the head office. They want to check out the company's cafe. They want to meet the main, sometimes some people want to meet promoters. Sometimes some people would prefer to meet the franchise managers. So if they have not done that, it becomes a bit harder. And we have seen that during pandemic, that usually before pandemic, we used to close up around 40, 45 new stores every year. That is what we have been doing consistently since last 8 years of franchising. But with this pandemic and all, we got time, we stopped, we thought about the process as how to take it forward. We changed across the model. As you told, we moved to technology. We were not too much online because it was more of a dine-in business, other than being on Zomato's and Swiggy's like a food business. But then it gave us too much of thought process and timing for us to think about that if customers are not coming to us, how do we go to them? If franchises are not coming to us, how do we approach them? So we made up our own websites. We went on Amazon, we went on Flipkart, we went on Big Basket, and we created our own e-commerce portal. And then as a managing director, we started taking one-to-one franchisee sessions with every territory, east, west, north, north, south, and India. Yeah, compared to 40, we were not able to close 40, but doing these sort of activities remotely, and now it's a new business model, you know, because till date, we are following remote only because the virus has not gone till now. And we don't want to be out of business and close our offices or stores again. So we have got onto terms. Rather than 40, we have already closed and started on with 10 new franchises. So it's nearly 25% of the business, but we are still happy to be safe and clear and staying around in this new post-COVID era, and believe so that once it finishes, we'll be up to the normal and businesses will be back to normal. So remote helps. I believe it's taking one step forward, making people understand rather than wasting time traveling and catching up with everyone. If you make them comfortable and get them be confident in your brand, making them visit to their own city or do some remote session with them online, it helps them to gain some confidence. So we as a brand would definitely, along with being online, would always prefer offline and online both after COVID now. That's what my word is.
Thank you, Vikas sir. You know, food industry has been one of the industries that's been hit very badly during the pandemic, especially for a brand like, for chocolate. Okay. Both the ends have suffered. Thank you, sir. Yes, over to Chinmay. Chinmay, sir.
Sure. So, according to us, our business has, to be frank, has increased by multiple folds. As there was major shortage, everybody overnight was using work from home, the required devices, was online schooling was there. And at same time, there was huge shortage in devices like premium products, like what we sell, Apple products. We have closed more about single orders of more than 100, 200 devices, and we get stock hardly. Second thing, what products was a push? For example, Zoom today, what the platform which we are using, Zoom and BlueJeans, to share with you, we were the first in Asia to introduce Zoom and BlueJeans in 2016 in India. So which was 100% a push product. Nobody knew what was Zoom. Earlier, those were days of Polycom, Cisco, you know what Tata is selling or any hardware. Typical, only so-called large enterprise used to buy video conferencing. Now it is in everybody's home, everybody has got devices. So those subscription sale has increased drastically. Third thing, in terms of IT infrastructure, overnight, everybody was concerned about security, which earlier nobody cared. So when it comes to firewall for homes or small offices or any kind of security, that was a major threat. I remember since first week of lockdown, probably I was working more than 10 hours in a day from home, which was exhaustive. And just to managing thing, it was not about selling or supply because it was not possible, but it was about engaging with customers, what exactly they require. Our main domain in Apple is education. So most of schools, colleges are our clients. So right from K-12, higher education, B schools. I'll give an example. We have this architecture college in Ahmedabad, SEPT, School of Architect. So SEPT, they probably bought 135 iPads with Apple Pencil, etc., whatever the requirement was. Probably that turnaround time, it took them 48 hours to buy that and supply that. otherwise, if it was non-pandemic, trust me, not matter of amount, but it was matter of their paradigm shift, of their way of thinking, their way of requirement, their urgency. They said that we wanted, we showed them, probably took competition, you know, Android versus Apple, Microsoft versus Apple, whatever they had to evaluate. It literally took them for less than 48 hours to get the deal closed. So this is just given an example. There are multiple such things, but yeah, awareness has increased a lot, and quite a lot, food tech, education technology, those all technologies have given birth to many startups have already started in pandemic. We recently also started another company in 1st June. We are into data analytics.
I'm sorry to interrupt, sir. Can you make it a little short?
Sure. Yeah. So, you know, that was credit goes to pandemic where we started another business as well.
Okay. Sure. Thank you. So as you said, there was a huge, focus on demand, but the supply was short of it.
Yes. Right.
All right. Thank you. Over to Niram, sir. Requesting the panelists to keep the answers very precise.
Sure. So, first of all, like when pandemic hit us, if you have asked me this in January 2020, we were not in a position to tell you that our 50% of the staff can work from home effectively. But then with, you know, the very, very pressing need of we becoming enabler for our clients, because we cannot go off the business for a second, given a lot of largest financial markets of the world are relying on us, be it stock market, be it all the investors, investment bankers, investment managers, everybody need our data and analytics all the time, 24/7. Given that it was a huge operation for us to make sure that all our 8,000 people across India go effectively at home and start working, connect back to the work and follow the same priorities that they follow in the office. It was tough, one, because we were largest consumer of the desktop. We realized first time, like it can be, you know, troublesome. But then we took a very, very fast call in making sure that we procure all 8,000 laptops and across the world, like 24,000 laptop overnight, and started shipping them, keeping our system in live until the, you know, laptops were delivered. The second thing we realized is we really need effective connectivity to homes through our VPN gateways. Make sure our infrastructure is robust and cybersecurity proof. Lot of work has been done by our partners across the world to make it happen. But then all our employees were effectively able to join and able to work as good as in the office. And the last thing which we did is to make sure that wherever our employees were not able to procure the internet, which was an essential thing on the very first day of the lockdown, we found out innovative ways to supply the internet to employees home by contacting directly to the service companies and make sure that we paid in advance and then their connection has reached to their home. But doing everything possible, we were able to keep the light on for our 24/7 365 engine, I would say.
So here we have someone who converted all the challenges into opportunities and worked on it. Yes, over to Pooja ma'am. I would like to hear from you.
So talking about us, we primarily cater to schools and colleges, and that was the biggest hit for our company, which basically dealt in, and we had the niche, which is just the school and college. So, I mean, we didn't lost hope, and we tried in, and you can say that it proved to be an opportunity for us, wherein we started concentrating on ambulance market, the staff bus market, wherein we have successful conversions in that as well. Talking about your question regarding challenges, it's like a boon for working mothers like me, wherein we can work from home and fulfill our dreams also. The biggest challenge phase was infrastructural development for a startup like us, wherein we didn't have technology in place. Like Neelam sir rightly said, they tried to make things available to the staff, but at that time we were confused wherein to how the infrastructure could be developed for the employees. But yes, we have tried to source as many details as possible and build in our team so strong that we are able to cater to other market and effectuate our product in different dimensions.
Thank you, Pooja ma'am. So this the question was, you know, basically the biggest challenges in enabling the remote working. But to be honest, remote working itself was a big challenge to a lot of organizations. All of a sudden, you know, work from home or sending them the laptops or making sure that they have a proper bandwidth. Everything was a complete, you know, complete chaos for the first few months. And again, the work from home or the remote working itself is a fancy word, but has a lot of pros and cons by itself. And one such operations in the work from home is the call management system. Right? So at this juncture, I'd like to, you know, pull in the charismatic Manu sir to understand from him the limitations of traditional call management system. Over to Manu sir.
I think the kind of input which we have received, especially the Neelam talked about it, like what happens that as and when that we have the traditional system in place, and while particularly you are asking about the call management system, you know, while our employees, they are coming to office and they are working from here, we have all these setups ready with us. Huh? And you know what we have incurred for this? We have incurred huge cost in form of EPBX. We have huge server room. And then we have the physical connectivity, which we took from any big ISP. Then we have arranged the UPS, then cooling system. And for managing all these, what we have done, that we have the skilled manpower who is managing this. And you know, then you have to have the even AMC, you have to upgrade your infrastructure. And then it is something which is the major concerns that we are having. As and when that you are going to scale it up, it is not possible. And downtime, again, it is going to be a big concern, and you have to coordinate with the multiple vendor. So just to pass this example, and the way Mr. Neelam talked about it, what happened suddenly while pandemic was there, and one of the Pune-based customer, the same kind of even call center they were having, and they realized the fact that the infrastructure which they have created, nobody is going to use this because people, they are not visiting office. And it was not work from home because the most of the people, they have moved to their native place. So frankly, it was work from everywhere. And on that sense that they were needing that the traditional system, frankly, it was not working because the kind of CapEx, OpEx they have invested on that part, frankly, it was not usable because the employees, they were not visiting that. And finally, what they have done, they took the smart flow solution from TTBS. And finally, while their agents, they were sitting at home, they were having the incoming and outgoing call coming in. And frankly, they were not requiring even the laptop and desktop also. And everything was getting managed even automatically from the cloud side. So that is something which is one of the best example. And hence, I can say this, the traditional call management system is having the own limitations. And as and when that we are going to have such kind of even pandemic, forget about today. Tomorrow it is going to happen like this, then again, we'll have the challenge. One more thing which I will like, this Mr. Chinmay talked about it. All these solution where here actually, but we were not using it. So frankly, while we are talking about the cloud telephony and the, even the cloud flow, smart flow solution, it was there, but we were investing heavily on the infrastructure cost. We were incurring a lot of CapEx, OpEx. We were hiring the skilled manpower to manage this. And finally, we realized that our employees are not able to come to office. They are operating from their native place. They are not operating from home. So like if the Muthu is from, he is working in Pune, he moved back to Coimbatore. Now we need the solution wherein that he can access the customer call, because we can't ignore the customer's call also, right? We have to be up 24/7. And this is what we discussed and we talked about.
Okay. Thank you, Manu sir. And also, because of the Tata Telebusiness services, the call management system has been completely overtook by this telephony services, and the workload has been reduced by one, the fraction. Thank you, Manu sir. And during this pandemic, you know, one thing which connects all the entrepreneurs is that mindset of thinking what next, right? So everyone will definitely agree with me. So whatever the problem comes right in front of us, we as entrepreneurs will always think about a solution and always move forward. What next is something that we are always trained about. So during this pandemic, there have been a lot of investments that the businesses have made with regards to the technology front. For a very instance, this Zoom itself was a huge investment that has been made by a lot of organizations to ensure that the business is still going on without any hassle. Speaking about which, I'd like to understand from the panelists once again, what kind of investments have business made with in terms of enabling remote working since the outbreak of pandemic? Right? So the technology investments you've made to enable remote working at the start of the pandemic, I would like to start again with Vikas.
Well, as I said before in my initial conversation, when you asked this question about remote, for us as being into a food brand, we would not go into too much of investments into office because as discussed before, no staff was suitable there at office. So our work basically goes on laptops or on phone, nothing else. We need to speak to our clients. We need to speak to our customers, but practically being all the restaurants and everything closed till May. So we were out of work. So there was no work at all what we can do because our work relies when customers walk in inside to the restaurants or cafes and we treat them, greet them and serve them products and all. But when we were off, we had a off time to understand, sit and plan as to what next after this. How do we sustain? Because we knew that these months are going up and up and dining in is not going to start again very soon. So what to be done? So when you talk about these remotes and technologies about F&B industry, it's something like that. You know, we had to get rid of thinking of customers coming to us, but we, our thought process was how to go to the customers. That's what we did. You know, we went ahead, we made up our online app. We got it to the customers. We started QR code ordering wherein customers can order through their app and we can deliver them once the lockdown is finished. We started WhatsApp ordering. So these all remote things work through us in this way. We started one-to-one connecting with them through some sort of communication, letting them know because practically till June ending, of course, in this part of Gujarat, till July, there was no one allowed to go to the cafes or restaurants seeing the current scenario and all. So this was the time in our industry, what we spent across thinking and processing what to do, what to plan. Rather than being the cafe, we converted our brand into an FMCG outlet, wherein we started opening new outlets after the pandemic slowed down with some lots of merchandise options, lots of snacks and chocolatey items, which were not there in before. It was basically a normal routine chocolate cafe. So it gave us time to think about go to remote, go to options, have these WhatsApp orderings and these cloud kitchens and all. For us, a cloud thing is a cloud kitchen, wherein we go to take orders on cloud kitchen. So that's where the cloud term comes in our industry, nothing else. That is not something great, but that is what we have done remotely to make sure to stay afloat and stay.
Sure. Wonderful. So yes, I think a lot of people during the pandemic especially missed chocolate rooms, chocolate bomb, I guess. But yes, as Vikas sir rightly said, one major leap in the technology, which has already been there, but very prevalent during this pandemic was that no-touch menu card system. You know, the QR code scanning and the no-touch menu card system was very prevalent and quite useful for a lot of people. Yes, over to Chinmay sir. Chinmay sir, are you with us? Yes, sir.
So, for us, as I mentioned, devices are the only thing what we sell. Video conferencing devices, the web cameras, which probably we have never sold in last ages. Nobody used to even ask for a web camera. Because, you know, every laptop has it, every tablet has it, iPad has it. That was a huge requirement. Overnight, people used to move their desktops from home to offices, offices to home. So that was one. Unified communication. So in terms of we are partners for a few brands, that was in very much demand. Large format displays, televisions, digital signage, those kind of products where people were investing in that. Apart from that, CRMs, softwares. Everybody wanted overnight had time to think about making IT SOPs. So that was a good thing we can say. People invested a lot in that.
All right. CRM has been a good investment, I believe, to a lot of SMBs, especially during the pandemic, to keep track of all the operations. Yes, Chinmay sir. Over to Neelam sir.
Yeah. So, you know, from our side, the investment was on multiple fold. I'll start with our people investment first. Because as we run operations, we need to make sure that in few tough time, if we be with the people, they will be always with us in any given challenge of the company. We started with making sure that we have overnight policies for everything that employees are going to be in need for next 2 years. Because we probably early estimated that this is not going to go away in next couple of months. It's going to be long-term affair and it will impact us a lot. So be it policy related to utility and electricity or internet allowance, IT allowances for monitor, keyboard, mice, home office setup, table, chair, well-being setup, making sure that our employees have an opportunity to buy those devices and buy those things on company's money so that they can get as good as experience they get in the office. That's our first mantra. So that was in less than 24 hours, we were able to reach to our employees doing town hall, email communication, as well as leadership call, assuring that people have the limits, no further discussion, they can go buy it and we can support that way. The second thing was the mental well-being of the employees. Working from home somehow is not as comfortable as working from office. While you can go around with the colleagues and take the tea or coffee and enjoy that casual talks, which really reduces the stress. Unfortunately, we're not left with that choices at this point of time. So we made an investment into a well-being app called AkinCare and made sure that all our employees are connected to us through that app, making sure that they take time to do some kind of Zumba yoga. Also make sure that in case anybody in within their family or they are COVID positive or showing the signs of it, they can go company-sponsored COVID testing, where employees can be tested at home and provided the report at home itself. So they don't need to go around. And we also started our a campaign called Essential Basic Support. So if any of the employees living distant, far from their relatives or families and have COVID positive scenario, we have supported them through providing the ration for everything on a monthly basis to make sure that they don't find anything in trouble, including mineral water, milk, fruits, whatever was in need. We supplied them on a daily basis, 3 times a day, whenever employee requested and confirmed us, to make sure that it's not it was an opportunity to showcase really that we are a family. From the technology perspective, as I said before, from desktop to laptop was another very shortest, less than 48 hours of call from our CEO to make a huge investment in upgrading all machines across the company. There were several laptops and majority of the functions were on laptop, but we still upgraded all of them. Investment in the VPN cloud setup, making sure that we bought Akamai, AWS, Azure, Citrix VDI cloud setup, so that whoever is able to connect to those cloud platform and continue their work, we provided that setup as a backup. So if the machine has any kind of issue with the hardware, they don't need to take on, they can take their personal laptop and start connecting to the online cloud setup. And then we also made a huge investment on the video conferencing tools like Zoom and Teams and Skype of the world to make sure that our people continue to get connectivity with their team members. We also introduced one concept called Thrive, which is a weekly call where the employee and manager talks informally, talk about their families and how hard that is, happy hours and celebration. So all that has really helped us.
Okay. Thank you, Nilam, sir. But I think one thing that really has to be applauded at this moment is that investment on employees that has been, primary set of focus on SAP Global. It is really something very great about companies sponsor the COVID test or providing patients and all of that. And also on the technological aspect as well. Thank you, sir. Yes, over to Pooja.
We being already into technology, we tried to upgrade our existing technology. We, as Madhu rightly said, we started using many CRM. We tried to explore them and find out best of us. Also, the challenge about the technology, it's more than about a challenge. It proved to be a boon, wherein we got incubated at IIM Bangalore. So it proved to be an opportunity for us, wherein we had to go there and pitch our idea, but then it was totally online. Talking about the employees, yes, we paid them in full. And as Nilam sir rightly said, we tried to make intact that all their needs are fulfilled at that time. Technological advancement, talking about, it's like training at home. Even the elder ones are trained at home how to use the technology. They know everything how to use it. So it's more of a digital era, but yes, we should make sure that we are not too much addicted into it. And there should be a work-life balance wherein we limit the working hours for the members also. So that's all from my side.
Okay. Now, I think we have yet another person who actually rode on a unicorn during pandemic. I think she used most of the pandemic with a lot of ideas and advancements. Thank you, Pooja ma'am. I'd like to, again, invite Mr. Manu Singh, sir, being the Vice President of Operations at Tata Telebusiness Services, there is one question which I would like to ask you. What are some of the digital strategies that can be deployed to harness simple and cost-effective communication? Over to Manu, sir.
Yeah. Okay, so then I'll give the answer to this. Before that, what I will do here, I will just refer one of the case study wherein that we will have at least one info coming in, and then followed by we will go for the outcome. One of the, I think, largest real estate broking company in West region, initially, actually, they were having the 6 branches, and they were keen to roll out the telecollab setup. Okay. And because any which way, the different branches, they were managing the different kind of customers, and locally they are managing everything. And somehow they have decided to go for the in-house solutions. And finally, because the cost was very high, because if you are going to have the setup branch wise, that you need to invest heavily on that part. So finally, what has happened, then they moved to cloud. And cloud is something which has given the different flavor to them, because they got the unique number, the incoming, outgoing, everything was there, and agent they can work from home. If it's geography wise, then they were getting the call and they were addressing this also. And they were having all the details in place in terms of complete recording of complete call conversations, lead details, call report and analysis. So with this case study, what we understand that the cloud telephony is the future, and cloud telephony is very simple and cost effective solutions. And the best part is that it is scalable and flexible. So just to pass an example, like if the customer is having a requirement of 50 calls per day, and tomorrow because of the client, then customer is needing 10 lakhs call per day, wherein that you will not able to scale up your existing setup, even arrangement, that you need to have something which should be on cloud, and you can scale from the 50 to even 10 lakhs call per day, that kind of thing. And as and when that you are going to have your infra set up in place, that you need the huge capex required. And you know, if you are going to create your infra, then you can't access from outside. You have to be within the premises to access this. And I feel like the cloud is solution for all this, wherein that you can manage this call from anywhere. Secondly, that you can merge this with the CRM and any other application easily. Call can be routed on even mobile phone also. Then you will have the benefit of IVR, voicemail, call blasting, call recording, and complete call analysis can be configured. And the best part is that for having this cloud telephony solutions, that you don't have need to interact with too much of vendors. I think you can take this from Tata Tele Business Services, and then you will have the one soft solution for everything. So I feel like if we need to have the digital strategy that can be deployed for harness the simple and cost effective communication is the cloud telephony.
Thank you, Manu, sir. So the cloud has become like an elixir for the remote working and digital business in today's world. Like, without cloud, nothing is able to properly function at all. And yes, this, as I said before, this remote working concept is definitely, you know, it sounds very fancy. The concept definitely looks very fancy, but it has its own set of pros and cons, as I said earlier. Speaking about which, I'd like to understand from the panelists, what are the biggest challenges being faced by businesses, specifically in terms of call management, collaboration, and communication with the clients? Requesting the participants to keep your answers very precise, I'll start with Vikas, sir. Over to you, sir.
See, as I said, in our industry, basically the communication works only if you catch up one-to-one. The conference and initiating a level of conference to work with someone only happens when you meet someone and gain some confidence that, yeah, there is something in the brand and they wish to go ahead. So with remote, things get to a bit extent that they take time to move forward. They take time to think about further expansion, or they take time to start up a new business entity or something like that. But with COVID being around for one and all, for everyone, I guess that helped, that some people who are quite educative, like people around from the technological industry, people around from, you know, Bangalore, people around from Hyderabad and all those places, where people were those high tech sort of a people and who had accepted working from home and all, they understood, because these are our major customers, those entrepreneurs who want to start up something other than their IT businesses and all, getting some locations in IT parks, having some small cafes or something like that. So these were the clients we jumped onto. They understood that, yeah, these are the times where we can even speak on remote. We have been to the cafes, we understand the brand, and we've had a one-to-one session with them. So they were the clients we focused on, we marketed on, we touched. And other side, they understood that in pandemic, this is how we can go forward. We can still open up, we get some nice locations and move forward and go across in the right way, rather than just sitting and thinking that let's wait for the pandemic to be over. So in some ways, we had to sideline our old ways of doing business and capitalize on the new things post-COVID, what we had understood that, yeah, if we focus on such sort of entrepreneurs rather than, you know, working on with one and around everyone, it'll go across on a slower way, but a steady way. So that's what it changed for us.
Thank you, Vikas, sir. Over to Chinmay, sir.
So what I figured out, I think time frame and decision making was not as smooth as we expected. That was the biggest challenge for products, or when we come to pitch anything, if it's a requirement, yes, it is, yes. But if it's a push thing where we need to educate client, that time taking in during pandemic was not easy. That was one of the biggest challenges, I feel.
I think push market really had a big challenge in the entire pandemic itself.
True.
That's true, Chinmay. Is over to Nilam, sir.
Yeah, so one thing which we have experienced from the client side is virtual onboarding to any of such a complex services and product is not easy. Like, our solutions are designed for the investment bankers and investment managers. If anybody newly starts it, they definitely need in-person training. But somehow, you know, everything was virtual. So we tried and we made sure that we onboarded them, but it wasn't that easy for them to take on a complex product set. The second thing which we understood is their engagement on our platform. So we needed to always identify or, you know, start new innovative ways to connect to them and make sure that they stick to our platform and continue to utilize and take the leverage out of the, you know, subscription they have taken. What I personally heard from some of my colleagues who are into the relationship management and account management, that internet or stable good internet is a key for, you know, doing any virtual business. And honestly, like, we do have a pretty good shape of internet in the country, but still it has a room for improvement, because a lot of time the call has dropped, and because of that the client hasn't got the best in cast experience that they should get, especially on the live conferencing. If you put up your virtual background, there is like your ear is cut or your hair is cut, doesn't give a good feel of, you know, impersonal natural effect. So we probably have a second, you know, level of enhancement required to happen for this industry, so that people can give more personalized and more impactful presence on the virtual platform. That's my opinion.
That's very true, sir. You know, there is always a scope for improvement in the user interface, especially on the, you know, the virtual side. But no matter how much the virtual has been developed, the one thing that we all really miss is that one-to-one, you know, personal meetings or that personal sales closing, which really proves to be a lot more effective when compared to the virtual. It's over to Pooja Ram.
Yeah, rightly said. I mean, one-to-one meetings are definitely required for the closures. But then talking about a global level or a global scale, there are companies which closes the order. And in our case as well, we could see many orders getting closed virtually. So it proved to be a good thing. I mean, you need not go every time. It's upon the rapport of the company, which is built up since years, and clients are taking the order. So I think it's like, instead of wasting time going there, making them understand, it's more of a refined structure when everything is in a written format, every idea is being, communicated through mail. So I think it's a good sign of doing the same. And secondly, talking about the challenge, you can say, as such, we didn't face any challenge because we proved the entire thing to in form of an opportunity by providing it to ambulance and staff buses. So, yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Pooja ma'am. Yes, we have one wonderful speaker who have joined us today, one panelist who have joined us now. Yes, Chandan sir, good afternoon, welcome sir.
Good afternoon.
Yes,
sir. A little bit late, got stuck up in somewhere.
No problem, sir. Thank you so much. So, as we are discussing on this panel, the current question that is going on is, what are the biggest challenges faced by the business, specifically in terms of call management, collaboration, and communication with the client? I'd like to understand your perspective, Chandan sir.
Okay. So first and foremost, I would like definitely like to share that, yes, there is always a two aspects of the, any situations. One is an opportunity which you get in, the second is a challenge which you face. So industry where I belongs largely, we are into the pharmaceutical and we are into the waste to energy. So in one segment of the business, which we are into pharmaceutical, we had a great opportunity, honestly. But we have been struggling a lot with, a local bandwidth, a kind of a local support from the vendors or even support, because a lot of the government agency was busy in the their managing the pandemic. But at the same time, our process got stuck up. But at the same time, we could able to learn it that, okay, there are the in-house capability which we can utilize better way than we were thought about before. So that is one of the, I would say, the challenge versus opportunity we got it. On infra side, which is we are into waste to energy, where depend on the labor people, because there are a lot of labor being used. And in these situations, the labor had a big issues we had facing. So that is where we realized that, yes, at the end of the day, you have to think about automation, because something which you can't manage a scale beyond, automations. So I think there are a lot of process involvement which we didn't realize before. But yes, that's give a chance of optimizing your organization's org structure, the processes, the way, behavioral organizations aspects, and a lot more than that. So I think we had a both coin or both side of the coin where we have seen in all our, both business differently. Of course, we are third into dairy and dairy product, but that has been, fortunately, has been grown a lot because of the demand. Is as simple as that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So
thank
I think that, for, that's, yeah, yeah.
All right. Thank you, sir. As you told, there was a lot of demand for the essential product during this pandemic, and people on that industry definitely had a good time through. Yes, so as Manu sir told earlier, he was talking about the cloud. So I would like to touch upon that topic once again. So as I told, cloud has become like an elixir for the digital business. Right? So without cloud, I don't think so there is much of an operations that could be made on a very large scale. So speaking about which, I would like to understand from Manu sir, how is cloud helping BPOs bring agility into their operations? Over to Manu sir.
Okay. So as we know, the BPO business is dynamic in nature. Hence, quick setup and the cost-effective manner is key aspects in which can be achieved through the cloud telephony. Because what happens, like if you have the large setup, just assume that there are 100 and 1,000 agents that you need to set up this. And for that the kind of infra and the kind of even capex that you are going to be incurred, it is going to be, I think, very costly. And this is the kind of seed that which we are creating, it is going to have the huge cost on that. But once we talk about the even cloud telephony here, that we have all kind of benefits coming in, because first thing, it's a flexible. Second thing, that you can scale it as much you can. So if you have five agents initially, you can reach up to 500 and 5,000 also. And how much time you will take? You will take it is going to be one call away. The call operator like us, we will do this from 5 to 500 or 5,000. So that is the one thing. Second thing, the cloud telephony also help in terms of API integration can be easily deployed in cloud telephony. BPO can save a lot of infra cost, and anytime they can upgrade this. There is also facility of the, you have the dialer facility in place, and you can improve and you can monitor the agent productivity and performance also, because you are going to have everything in place that you can monitor the call, you can check their performance, you can check their productivity, how much calls they are making it. That means you can monitor all kind of reports of your agent. And one of the additional thing that you can have the superior features like call whispering, call barring, and three-way conferencing, all these is there. and it is easy to deploy and flexible enough to change the office location. And as I said this, because in I've seen this in Pune and Ahmedabad, while people, they have moved to their native place, it was very difficult for the BPOs to run the SOAP. But as and when they have even taken the BPO part, now it is a matter of only chipping the calls. Like if your agents are sitting in Bihar or UP or somewhere else also, then you are engaging them and you are monitoring their performance, their productivity, and everything is getting corrected. And one of the best example I will give in West region, at least one of the large aggregator who was doing close to 1 lakh calls on a daily basis. And suddenly he got an opportunity for Himachal Pradesh government, wherein they have asked to call everyone because of a certain region. And they were asking this aggregator to have at least 20 lakhs call per day. And you can assume for setting the infra for even releasing the 20 lakhs call, you can assume the kind of investment that you are going to do. Close to it is 1.5 to 2 CR kind of investment was there. And while they have approached us, we have given the solution of cloud telephony. And we said like this BPO related kind of business that you can manage with this. And customer is paying only 3 lakh kind of OPEX to us on a monthly rental, I can say this. And he is managing close to 10 to 20 lakhs call per day. So that says all about the flexibility and scalability and the security, or even though agents, they are not able to aware about that, which kind of data they are accessing, everything is cloud-based, right? So taken care of.
Thank you, Manu, sir. I think at this juncture, we'd all like to, you know, take a moment to thank the Tata Teleservices for their wide range of services, especially on the digital front, enabling all the SMBs to increase their productivity. Like for an example, when you talked about the cloud telephony services, Manu, sir, from 2.5 CR to just 3 lakh, you know, definitely a drastic saving when it comes to the SME front. Thank you.
Any which way, all the business heads are here and they know gone are the days wherein that we used to incur too much capex to do all this, right? Now we want that it should be OPEX model. And I think Neelam is one that who knows this very well. Technologies are also changing drastically. If today we are using something else, tomorrow something else will come. And we know our core competency is very, very different. And what I will suggest that we as a business that we all need to concentrate on our core competency, but we should have one of the telecom solution provider who can play the catalyst role and who can help us to grow our business.
Exactly. I just would like to add on one point here. While you take any technology decision, the amount of capex that used to be invested, now that lifespan is shortened to maximum 2 to 3 years. On a given technology, you won't be more than 3 years. And so we need to be very mindful, focusing on OPEX side rather than capex side. I can't agree more. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Manu, sir. I think since Chandan, sir, joined us a little late, I would like to pull him inside to understand his perspective on just one question. Chandan sir, as we all know that there were a lot of investments that the organizations made on terms of digital. So, for example, Zoom itself is a huge investment on the digital front for a lot of companies to enhance that the business is going amidst the COVID. Speaking about which, I'd like to understand what were the digital investments that your business made in terms of, you know, enabling the remote working?
So, I think everyone now realize that the way forward is a digital. So the traditional outlook, which we as an industrialist, we had it, that everything has been controlled, manual, under one watchdog. So that, I think, era has now already gone, I guess. This recent pandemic has clearly taught us very clearly, any organization, it's a large or big, okay, any part of the world, I mean, pharma or chemical or any other industry, there is one common thread is nowadays called a virtual life or virtual operating office. We as an organization, definitely, we didn't have concept called MS Office, honestly. Everyone we knew is Excel and Word and PowerPoint. But there's nothing called a MS Office where we can, you know, talk, you can share the file, you can operate from any part of the world. And of course, we were in SAP, and therefore that gave us a flexibility to operate anywhere there. But yes, we definitely has migrated a physical meeting to a virtual meeting. A lot of meetings now happen within an organization also on a Teams meetings, MS Team meeting. And yes, Zoom is definitely a platform, but we organization largely moved out to the MS Team, I would say.
Okay. So MS Team has been a big investment from your side.
Big investment. Very true. Yes. Very true.
I think most of the panelists today had touched upon this thing very commonly. The technology was always been there. It has already been there. It's just that the pandemic had forced us, you know, to get ourselves equipped to it.
It's just like realization of that the era has changed and we've been lacking behind, honestly.
True. Wonderful. Thank you, Chandra, sir. At this juncture, I'd like to understand for the panelists, again, on a generic generic aspect, one thing that worked very well for your business that you'd like to share with the others. So this will be the question. One thing that worked well for your business that you'd like to share with the others, requesting the panelists to keep your answers very precise. I'd like to start with Vikas, sir.
Well, what it worked for us was, repeating again what I said, being present on the online platform. We had always been offline amongst the customers, serving the customers and all, and never gone through at the moment of thinking about being online and how strong an online presence can be, and changing our whole brand portfolio to getting into a bit of FMCG by adding lots of merchandise stuff for the customers at all, because if anything like this happens again, I believe it shouldn't, but if anything happens like that, we need to be ready and we need to be prepared that, yeah, if customers are not coming, then we need to be under the essentials category, that we have some essential products, some essential merchandise lying within our stores, so we can be available and serviceable to the customers during any type of pandemic as well. So that is what it has taught us. And that is what we'll go forward in the future as well, keeping that in mind. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Vikas. I think a lot of very familiar brands started the merchandise options during this pandemic, selling a lot of, you know, very interesting stuff. Thank you. Thank you, Vikas, sir. Here, I'd like to pull in Chinmay, sir. I would like to understand from you. Over to you.
So, couple of new products line which we added. One was UVD, ultraviolet products, wherein buzz. So, we have a product called UVD robots, which was one of a unique thing that was something what we... Before pandemic, I didn't know what it was, and probably our largest revenue came from that product this pandemic. Apart from that, multiple collaborations we done with some Polish companies, few companies from Poland in EdTech. That was a big advantage to us.
Okay. Thank you, Chinmay, sir. Yes, Chandan, sir.
I think we had a lot of attraction in pharma, honestly, in the area of M&A. Definitely we had got opportunity to acquire and of course to deleverage some of our IPs to a US company called Baxter. So that was a opportunity has been created in the process.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Yeah. Yes, I would like to understand from Neelam, sir. Over to you.
So when we looked into our part of the story, mostly it's about running the operations with minimum possible impact. And we are very happy that more than 100% of the delivery that we committed for the year were completed. And the most important thing that we were successful, or we feel that has, you know, led that, is being empathetic to our people and our client. Making sure that whatever the pain areas they are facing through, find out a solution for them. Regular check-ins, different engagement through different platform has helped us understanding their real challenges and turning those challenges to opportunities for better satisfaction.
Thank you. Thank you, Neelam, sir. Is over to Pooja, ma'am.
The entire pandemic proved to be an opportunity. The biggest one is acquiring a major two hospitals, top hospitals of Mumbai, using TrackNow services. And another feather in the cap, as rightly said, IIM Bangalore. So all this, and also we are meeting virtually now. So I think all these things is again an opportunity in disguise.
Okay, noted. So everyone has a lot of different strategies that have been implemented that really work for each and every one of the organizations. So I would like to understand from Manu, sir, you know, based on the Tata Telebusiness Services perspective, one thing that worked very well for your organization that you'd like to share.
Yeah. So I think it was an opportunity for us because, you know, while most of the customers, they were operating from home or they were operating from everywhere, they were needing 24/7 uptime. And our team, at least close to 300 people, they were working on ground. And we have managed to ensure that we have maintained our SLAs, and customers, they were very happy with our product and services. Also, most of clients, they have started looking for the work from home solution kind of services, you know, because while employees, they were not visiting office, they want that they have to help their customers, and for which they were needing the at least technology support from our side. And we, along with our solution architect, we carved out and basis the requirement that which we have done that. So I have given any which way a couple of example in terms of how the large BPO or even call center, the agent, they have moved to anywhere and they were keen to support their customers, and they were connecting and they were taking the calls from the customers, they were closing the orders. So all end-to-end solutions that which we have managed, and I think kudos to all the team members. They have worked 24/7 to help B2B business for West region.
Manosa, is maybe I would like to, you know, end the session with a very lighter question, maybe to touch upon your lifestyle during this pandemic. So one thing that we all had to do during this pandemic was to keep a track on what is happening, you know, the update on the news, and both in terms of the COVID and also with regards to the business aspect of it. So I would like to understand from everyone who joined us today, what did you read or watch to get your business updates? So I'd like to start with Vikas, sir.
Well, you know, reading all different types of books, learning how to sustain during these times, because food and beverage industry has nothing more to do with
good
it.
One.
So managing all the new models, how to get it forward and how to be positive, and thinking about handling all the customer relations and management issues with this many 350 franchises on board. So it was all about talking to them, interacting with them, and having some positive thoughts around, nothing else. And yes, being into a food industry, making lots of food and keeping calm and composed. That's all, nothing else.
I think a lot of the self-proclaimed coaches online did just one thing that what this five-star advertisement says. Do nothing. You know, the best way to, you know, fight this is just do nothing and be quiet. So, yes, I would like to understand
Chinmay
sir's point of view.
So, honestly, during pandemic, there were too much of information. There were multiple Zoom overnight. People were overwhelmed within particular tech field. So, there were too much of information. We tried to keep whatever relevant to us. Initially, people were overexcited. Otherwise, whatever industry insider news from vendors, those were the best teaching, apart from few tech blogs.
Blogs and inside vendors
were the source
for you.
Yeah.
Yes, or to Nilan, sir.
Yeah, as Vikas said, you know, understanding from different sources of what's going on, what are the new challenges has turned, you know, life on the south. I think that was the biggest, source from where I used to learn about new challenges that is coming probably the next day. And we do have a very strong corporate security arm, keeping eyes across the world 24/7, keep us informed on what could be expected. But I think, you know, other than that, keep yourself clear, concise, and composed, rather than, you know, be very much worried about the pandemic or what can go wrong. I think that was really helpful.
Yeah. Thank you, Nilam sir. Yes, over to Pujama.
I became a big fan of 5 a.m. club of Robin Sharma. So yes, that was a good thing I've learned during that time. And it was a learning for every one of us, I think so, wherein maid was the biggest issue at that time. So we tried to understand that, yes, everyone is important. So it's a learning we have got during that time.
Okay. 5 a.m. club by Robin Sharma. Definitely,
yes.
Interesting. Definitely interesting. Yes, Chandan sir.
So I think honestly, I mean, first couple of days or weeks, I would say it was a real pandemic at home to figure it out how to manage the routine life. Because one side, you don't know what happening at the office, how to manage. And on the other side, there is a home culture, which you hardly stay back, you know, during the day. But yes, I think largely, I personally spent time on a virtual office. There was a deal going on, so we're talking with the lawyers, managing the different time of India and US. So that was one aspect. Second was, during that process, as a management took a lot of decisions to upgrade the IT infrastructures. So, you know, managing that the online, you know, there was a lot of training was given to the team member, how to become an online, to be aware or align and learn how to run the shows from sitting at home. So I think there was two new learning, I would say, which personally I had it over and above the, what the routine life we used to live it.
Okay.
Yeah, that's so
training
it.
On to adapt the digital normal was from your end, and that's wonderful. Yes, I would like to also hear from Manu sir. What do you?
Yeah. So the way Mr. Chandan said, because initially what I realized, the fact that somehow, because while we are managing the B2B customers and at least a couple of product and services, we are market leader in West region. I realized the fact that somehow that we were working very hard actually, because the customers, they were chasing us, they were needing the solutions, and we also need to ensure that none of any customers should get impacted. They have to have a 24/7 connectivity. Somehow what I have seen that we spoil our routine work, because if you are coming to office, you know that you follow the set of rules. And unfortunately, the kids are also, they were at home. And the way Pooja said, like one side it is blessing, the other side is disregard also, because you have to manage everything. Your wife also expect that you do a little bit help to her also. And what I realized that it was like roller coaster ride for us, okay? And then I decided that we have to create a timetable wherein that all of us that we should strictly follow what kind that one kind of time frame that we are going to invest on what kind of things. And luckily it has helped. We started and we started the routine like office while we were operating from home, and we have given time frame to everything, even for the reading books also, that we created the time frame and how much time that we are going to invest on TV or even on OTT, everything that we fixed. And that has started even responding as well. And I think we have started enjoying that also while we were managing both the work-life balance.
Thank you, Manu sir, for that. Like a mixed kind of an opinion once again. And I think with that, we come to the end of today's session. But before I just talk about it, I really had a very wonderful interaction with all the lovely panelists for the last 60 minutes. We had both the ends of the experience today. One, we had person who are, who had struck really bad during the pandemic, and the other side, we had people who were really rode on the unicorn during the pandemic, who really had the time of their life, for boon for certain people, bane for the others. But at the end of the day, one thing we must all agree to the fact is we all swam across it, and we all reached the surface now, and we're all at the survival mode. So for that, I think everyone deserves a huge round of applause for all the lovely panelists. With that, I'd like to invite Manu sir for a crisp closing thought. Over to you, sir.
Yeah. So thanks everyone. And I, on the behalf of Tata Tele Business Service, would like to extend vote of thanks to our speaker who blessed us with their presence and took out valuable time to join this panel discussion. Rising to the challenge, the topic is any which way, it is very critical and important during this pandemic time. The good thing is like all of you that you share your thought process, your experience, knowledge with example, and it was very easy to understand. Thank you very much, and a special thanks to Muthu, who has moderated it effectively and made it grand success. So Muthu, thank you very much for your support. The way that you engage us, I think I really appreciate the same. And looking forward for having more such interactions in future.
Thank you, Manu sir. And with that, we come to the end of today's session. Thank you so much, dear panelists, for joining us with us today and staying till the very end. I wish you all a grand success on your professional front on behalf of the talk. Until next time on yet another interesting episode of the CEO Talk, Rising to the Challenge with Tech Advantage. This is me, Muthu, signing off. Have a great weekend ahead. Thank you, man.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone.